Have either of you ever seen a UFO?
I've seen something that could possibly have been a UFO. It was a strange light in the sky. I couldn't explain it any other way. I wasn't the only person who saw it.
Pinkish, whitish light moved across the sky upwards. So anyway, it was a very clear view. It was a clear night. It was not an airplane.
You could have some major reaction on the part of the populace. You could have panic. You could have some major fear. And
some of the truth about it is being concealed.
Bill, I understand you've just published a new book called Cosmic Top Secret. Can you describe what that book is about in a couple of sentences?
Yes, what I'm trying to do here is trace the development of the early government crash retrieval operations, like the Roswell incident, and what has taken place since that time up to the present time. In other words, if there were such recoveries as alien spacecraft and alien bodies that were taken up to places like Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, we believe they didn't just put them in cold storage and let them sit there, but they were an object of scientific and engineering study. So over a period of time, there had to be a development cycle like there is in any engineering or scientific project. And there must be evidence today that that knowledge is being utilized by various scientific agencies and probably the aerospace industries at this time.
Do you have any of that evidence that you can describe right now?
Yes. Let me remark that there are two kinds of routes this evidence travels. Okay, one is by informants. That is, people who have worked on some phase of a secret or classified project that's dealing with this alien technology. And the other route is to go out to certain locations where there are secret installations and to do some observations. And there are witnesses who have gone out to these locations and they have seen evidence of advanced technology. The principal one, of course, that is well known is at the Nevada test site. Now, I've been following that for almost 10 years. When there was a report that came out in the early 80s that there was a secret project being conducted at the northern end of the Nevada test site, referred to as Project Red Light. And so this sparked my curiosity. And of course, today we know that John Lear, son of Bill Lear, has come out with statements about what's going on in the Nevada test site. And we've heard about Bob Lazar and his involvement. And there have been other trickles of stories coming out of the Nevada test site, all indicating that there's a very strong possibility that alien technology is being tested at this test site. And if it is, then it's only part of a very large program of some magnitude, and there must be other feeder lines elsewhere and other activities and operations going on elsewhere. Well, I moved out to 10 acres in the West Antelope Valley and soon discovered that I was barely maybe 8 miles away from a secret Northrop installation in the Tehachapi Mountains. And this installation came to my attention during a period of time in the summer of 1988 when a couple, the man whose name is Ray, was an inspector on the B-2 project at Northrop, okay, and he had gotten off a swing shift, and he and his girlfriend Nancy had gone up on this plateau, which is just outside of the perimeter fence area of this secure installation up there in the saddle of the mountains, and they saw a very strange object at about 1 o'clock in the morning when they were up there just looking at the lights, the stars, and what have you. And they saw what they described as being approximately a basketball-sized glowing orb rise out of the ground, okay, and gain some elevation, and it was to the east of them, less than about 100 yards away, and it just kind of sat there flashing, and there were electrical sparks coming off of it, and they were observing this for some minutes, when next they noticed that the first dawn rays of sunlight were coming up over the eastern horizon, and they had some missing time. And Ray was put under hypnosis, and he told a very bizarre tale of being taken underground to a what appeared to him to be a military installation. There were electronics, there were console panels, there were military uniformed men walking around. And he saw Nancy being put on this table, and surrounding the table were what he described as little gray alien beings, the typical large-headed, almond-shaped eyes, what have you. And at that point in his narration, he got very emotional, and he seemed to be blocked mentally in recalling the details of what happened to Nancy. He was very disturbed about this. And I considered that he was going through some genuine emotion. Now, they reported this, by the way, to somebody at Edwards Air Force Base because they thought, what's going on here, right? And they had some harassment afterwards, and they decided to withdraw, and they wouldn't even talk to me anymore. And just a few short months after that, on the night of the 26th of October, 1988, two very large boomerang-shaped objects flew over the West Valley, accompanied by about 17 disks. And they flew over this installation in the Tehachapis, and it grew very active after their flyover. And these objects were also seen later that night in the Fresno area, and it made the newspapers. Okay, and I've been told, even by one of the engineers there, and he was very convincing, and he said, boy, if people do not believe that these aliens exist, I can assure you that they do.
If what you're saying is true, it paints a very disturbing picture of government activity and obviously things that the American public know very little about. Can you summarize what you would like to advise the American public in terms of how to respond to this information?
I think what we need to do, of course, is air all of the testimony and all of this information as much as possible through the media, and see what we can do to bring pressure for a congressional investigation of some kind. And in fact, I understand, as in regards to the Roswell incident, in regards to the testimony of these people, they're trying to record all of that and bring it to the attention of some of the congressmen involved, in order to at least see that some kind of ethical oversight might be implemented over some of these programs. I think it's important that that be done, and I think that it's important that the public be made aware, not of national security secrets so much as just the fact that we do have an alien presence and that we are developing this technology, and be assured that we're not developing this technology for some malevolent purpose.
Thank you, Bill Hamilton, author of Cosmic Top Secret. Would you hold your book up for the camera, Bill? How much does it cost, and where can you get it?
Okay, this will be $8.95 when it's in bookstores. You can order it mail order from Inner Light Publications in New Brunswick, New Jersey.
Attempt to find your own truth, because that's where the answer lies, That's where the answer has always been, and that's where we've fallen down as a people. We have stopped investigating. We have stopped searching for the truth. We have stopped reading. We have stopped reading opposing viewpoints and listening to opposing voices. And we have become a nation of sheep who are following who knows what, but who knows where. When I left home, I joined the Air Force. I went into the Strategic Air Command, where I was an aircraft and missile hydraulic technician, which is a fancy word for air and fluid under pressure, which operates most of the systems on modern aircraft. While in the Air Force, I met people who told me, after they had had quite a few beers under their belt, or whatever it was that they drank, and to be honest, I was drinking also, and also had quite a few under my belt, they would tell me stories of having participated in with teams that recovered crashed extraterrestrial spacecraft, not of this Earth, and transporting these craft to secret military installations where they could be studied, or from there transported on to somewhere else. They didn't know that it would be the ultimate destination. One sergeant told me that he was on a team. His name was Sergeant Meese. He was on a team in Texas that transported a craft that was so large that on a flatbed truck, they only moved it at night. They had to have a team go ahead and take down fence posts and telephone poles in order to be able to pass along the back roads because they could not use the main highways. These roads were closed to normal traffic during this time, during the night. Before the sun would come up, they would have someone who had gone ahead and either leased or purchased a piece of property where they would set this object during the daylight hours covered and under military guard, and the next night they would resume their journey. Of course, it took quite a while to move something like that, but they did it. Behind them, another team came, replaced the fence posts and the telephone poles and anything else that had been taken down so that it could pass. Quite honestly, I was a young man. I wasn't interested in that kind of stuff. It's interesting, but it really wasn't where my head was at, and I didn't really believe it anyway. I was really interested in Susie in the bar more than I was listening to the sergeant tell me about working all through the night, transporting something that I didn't believe in the first place. But my sense of adventure had not been satisfied. Left the Air Force, and I decided, seasick or not, I'm going to the Navy, because that's really what I wanted to do. I went into the United States Navy, volunteered for submarines. Everything I've done all my life has been just absolutely crazy. Got submarines, was stationed on the USS Tyro, USS 416, Pearl Harbor Submarine Base, Hawaii, where during a transit from the Portland, Seattle area to the Pearl Harbor submarine base, as the port looked out, I witnessed an object, it was a disc-shaped object, commonly called a flying saucer, come up out of the ocean, tumble on its axis, and disappear into a low layer of clouds. I was dumbfounded. All my life I'd heard stories about these things and didn't believe it, but here I was looking at one, and it was the size of an aircraft carrier. And before I could even raise my binoculars off my chest this time, either the same object or another one just like it came down out of the clouds, and it was like a hole just opened up into the ocean, and this thing just followed right into the hole. And Symbol's mouth dropped to his chest, his binoculars dropped. He turned around and looked at me and said, "This had to happen to my watch." And we still don't know to this day why it happened or what was going on, but I do know this. I know that it was metal and that it was a machine. And that we were not suffering from optical illusions, delusions, insanity, or anything else. It was metal, it was a machine, it was intelligently guided. The only question in my mind was who the hell was flying the damn thing? We were told that it was classified, that we were not to discuss it, not even amongst ourselves. Now, After I left Vietnam, I was sent to serve on the intelligence briefing team, Commander Chief of the United States Pacific Fleet at Matlapa, Hawaii, but at that time was Admiral Bernard Clary, and I served there between the years 1970 and 1973. Also stood Petty Officer of Watch duty in the command center, during which time I was the designated speak-out operator for the crypto machinery in the command center message center. So my primary duty was to serve on the intelligence briefing team, my secondary duty, which was watch standing. While I served on this briefing team, I saw top secret compartmentalized information that told me that extraterrestrials are real, that they're here, that UFOs are machines, not things from other dimensions or blobs of plasma or anything else, but machines that these beings fly. Now, I'm also going to tell you that I don't know if that's really the truth or not, because I have found reference to a plan that goes all the way back to the beginning of this century, a plan by the secret societies that really control the governments of this world to create an artificial alien threat from outer space in order to unite all of humanity in a one-world government to face that artificial threat from outer space. Now, isn't it incredible that we've been prepared by sightings of UFOs over all this period, and then when the sightings and UFOs become unbelievably numerous, more than any time else in the history you see on television, AT&T, one world, one car, and you hear George Bush suddenly begin talking about a mysterious new world order. I'm not telling you that that's what's happening, but I'm telling you it's a very, very strong possibility. When you begin to really research this and drop all your bigoted ideas and all of your own prejudices and quit saying this can't be or that can't be or I'm not going to look at this because it doesn't pertain, and you really start looking into this, you find that not only is it possible, it's highly probable. You also find that there's tremendous evidence exists that extraterrestrial visitation is taking place. You see, I don't know the answer, and I don't pretend to, but I am after the truth, and I am really concerned about the United States of America and about our Bill of Rights and about our Constitution, and that's what drives me. I don't really care about all the other stuff. I think it'd be real neat if extraterrestrials are here. It'd be the most significant thing in the history of mankind. But I'm going to tell you this. If they're real, they're going to be used as an excuse to take away our rights and form a one-world socialist totalitarian government that's been in the planning and can be proven beyond any shadow of a doubt is going to happen. Process of taking place right before your very eyes at this time.
We're here this evening with Brad Steiger, one of the most prolific authors and lecturers on the UFO phenomenon, author of the recent title UFO Abductors, among many others. Brad, I wonder if you could tell us in a few words what UFO Abductors is about.
The UFO Abductors handles the mystery of abduction from what I hope is a balanced perspective of looking at all aspects of what abduction can be. Are they actual physical encounters in which people are truly examined by doctors from outer space? Are they experiments in somehow a mingling of divergent species done in the laboratory, perhaps with sperm and egg from human or aliens somehow blending together? Is the UFO abduction a spiritual experience? Is it a mental experience? Is it an astral projection? Is it truly taking place on the physical level, or is it part of a larger plan, again guiding us and somehow coercing us in one sense to become something other than we might expect that we can be? I think the UFO phenomena in general really defines the parameters of what it is to be human, and we can't really separate the UFO phenomena from a study of ourselves, who we really are, where we're really going, what is our future, what is our past, and how do we define ourselves, I think also defines the UFO mystery.
Abduction is a very hot topic right now, and there's seems to be a fairly set theory about what it is. It sounds as if you've got a much broader perspective on that, but do you yourself have a pet theory, at least, about what abduction really is?
The easy answer to abduction is there are small little gray entities that come across billions of miles of space to somehow examine us and appraise us physically. The motive for that can be, as we said before, just to see what we are as a species or to somehow interact with us. Then, of course, we are dangerously close to this kind of phobia that anything foreign to us must harm us, must be dangerous to us. We have to talk about another fad. It wasn't long ago when we saw cute little E.T., and then we had a lesson that just because it doesn't look like us doesn't mean it can't be loving and have the heart light shining out to us. Well, I think the answer again is somewhere in the middle, because we again as human beings have both aspects within us.
I commissioned this to be drawn based on hundreds of sightings, police artist style. And again, we see ears on these entities, because I said, why not? Go ahead and put them on. It's about 50-50, people who describe ears or describe simply the large skull. But again, the very large staring eyes. And we have them here pictured taking soil samples, because the Grays, if you want to call them that, seem obsessed with testing our planet. Well, and of course, E.T. then, one of the most popular motion pictures ever made, as some people have said, Spielberg himself was channeling. Spielberg himself was preparing our species for a great interaction with another species that wouldn't look quite like us, but we shouldn't be so suspicious because they aren't really bad guys. Remember Elliot when he first finds them in the cornfield? I mean, he is frightened. He is, and when we see that long black reptilian thing squeal, we jump too. But we come as Elliot did to feel an affection. Now again, is that part of brainwashing technique? Is that part of a programming to help us prepare? Those are the questions that are being asked now. Are they good guys or bad guys? Now the reptilian species, the evolution is possible. Two Canadian scientists took the long-necked one, the Nakasaurus, and said that certainly the reptilians, if they were left alone, and now remember, we're finding out they're probably warm-blooded, they weren't cold-blooded reptilians, they weren't reptiles as we think of them today. But Stenocosaurus had a large brain, it had a prehensile thumb, and if he would have evolved today, they say he might look very much like the large-headed fellow with not very much of a nose, but with nostrils, but not lips, but with a straight line. And again, I think you will say with me that that doesn't look far away from the average sighting.
Christian medical missionaries might come into an area. They know there's going to be a typhus epidemic. They inoculate the villagers. They round them up. The villagers don't know what's happening. All of a sudden, these white people in white uniforms with red crosses are sticking them. Maybe someone becomes ill. Maybe someone even dies. So they say, depending on what happened and their level of understanding, these evil beings that came and stuck us with needles and made some of us sick and made some of us die, only a few would have the awareness to say, perhaps a few lost their lives, but they saved so many of us because of this epidemic. For all we know, they could be coming down and testing us. Maybe they could be then guiding certain of us to come up with a cure for AIDS, but they might have to test certain of us. I'm not saying that's the case, but neither can we say dogmatically what they're doing, because we don't know. Maybe it's a process of genetic engineering. So again, is this a phenomenon that's always been with us? Is this an awareness that's always been with us? Is this a truth that's always been with us, that we have a companion species with whom we have a very subtle symbiotic relationship, that they probably know more of the ramifications than we do? We may be the younger species. We may be the older species. They may be patterning themselves on us. There's just question after question after question.
It was about 3 o'clock in the morning in Baytown, Texas. I was with a date. I was about 17 years old. My date and I were making out on the pier, and we were laying down, we were looking up at the stars, and he studied astrology. And he says, wow, you know, there's these three stars up there that make a perfect triangle. Isn't that interesting? I don't recall anything like that. We started looking at it for a while. And again, this is in the middle of the night. We'd had a full date before then. And the very top of the triangle exploded. And when it exploded, this little red light came from it. And it went slowly, slowly trailing down to the next point on the triangle. When it got there, it exploded, and then another green, like a green tiny star, traveled over to this one. It exploded again, and then by the time we watched this little green thing explode, I think that was something not of this earth.
Absolutely for sure, and it is a source of great concern. We here are engaged in a conversation about all of this, and perhaps you thought it was merely a very interesting curiosity. I know that some of you didn't think that, but perhaps some of you are here on that level. Let me invite you to change your attitude about that. Let me invite you to say to yourself, I don't understand this, and I don't even necessarily want to believe it. I mean, if you need to say that, because I certainly did, and I understand if that's how you need to feel about this. Take the step of educating myself as best I can. I will talk about this. I will attempt to take this seriously because, my friends, we really are dealing with one of the most profound occurrences in all of history, and it does and will shape our future in an absolutely dramatic way.
Something strange happened for the first time in UFO history in the United States. These spheres, these balls, started to appear, 14 of them in all. Three legs telescoped open and a small craft touched down to the ground. Here are the balls. An aerodynamic impossibility, spinning or remaining motionless in the sky, some of them rolling around in the grass. Here we have another series of pictures taken by the same gentleman who has a knack of being at the right place at the right time. And many UFO debunkers are so envious of this man, it isn't funny. As this started coming closer to the ground, he kept taking pictures of the craft over his truck. It opened like a clam, exposing a series of portholes or windows. NASA is famous for keeping secrets. During the Truman administration, unidentified flying objects were photographed circling what's called restricted air corridors. In Washington, you're not allowed to fly anywhere near the official buildings. The funny thing about this story was when our airmen were sent up to investigate, they could not visually make any contact with these objects at all, but yet they were still viewed from the ground and the pilots couldn't see them. And as the story goes, suddenly the planes found themselves surrounded by these UFOs, and that night many of those pilots got religion. Next. Here we go. Over restricted area in 1952. Here we have a strange case of a UFO that landed in a place called Milan, Italy. My wife and I were over there not too long ago. The witnesses claim that they saw this thing land in the snow. They had just come from high mass, and they were running toward the object, and they saw this person slip out of the object, slide down the right side of it, looked like he was encased in
be said that the alien presence is building toward an unprecedented self-revelation. I believe there is a clear sense, and I find this idea shared by many researchers around the country, there's a clear sense that the alien presence is becoming much bolder, much more assertive. They want us to know they're here.
I believe it's highly possible. I don't know if they're visiting us. I believe it's highly possible that they're out there, yeah. I think that's ignorant to think they're just not possible.
So you're saying that you have personally viewed objects on the moon that are not just part of the moon?
That's correct. I had a sighting with eight people. Together we were at the elevation of 7,000 feet where we set up our telescope, where we observed two nights in a row three enormous large objects in the crater Archimedes, and cigar-shaped, one crater in the northern part, spacecraft in the northern part, and two in the southern part of the crater. So when I made contact with other people that were interested in the same subject here, they confirmed my findings, because they too had seen different objects, large objects on the moon.
That sounds like something that would have to be seen by professional astronomers at the big observatories. Are they talking?
Some of them do, some of them don't. I remember one case of Walter Haas, was a professional astronomer that in the 1940s already had observed these mysterious objects on the moon and moving lights, and he had organized a group of astronomers that observed hundreds of these objects over a period of several weeks.
Now, as I understand it, your book talks about things that NASA found, that the astronauts found when they went there. What did they find?
For instance, astronaut Stafford made a statement that he is observing right now very pretty little volcanoes on the moon. They found by leaving seismic instrumentation on the surface that there is still seismic activity that's registering there. That means that the moon is not a dead place, that something is taking place inside in its interior. They found water, geysers spraying water over a wide area on the lunar surface, and they also, when the Apollo astronauts approached a surveyor spacecraft that had landed there earlier by remote control, they removed the camera system, and the whole spacecraft was thoroughly sterilized, everything. And when they brought the system back to Earth, they found microbes, not only on the lens outside, but also inside the lens, growing in the camera system. And so consequently, microbes, according to my interpretation, means there's something alive. And that if there are microbes on the moon, that may lead to other living things.
And what about the alien bases themselves? What evidence have you got of that, and what do you think is there?
From my studies and my photographs, I find many, many oval and cigar-shaped and round glowing objects on the moon. And on the lunar backside, I have studied an area that shows 10 objects neatly parked in rows. Of course, it takes about 14, 15 times enlargement to see anything clearly, halfway clearly. But still, you can know for sure that this is something that is artificial. It's not artificial, but it's man-made, because there are rows lined up of seem to be like egg-shaped objects, or oval objects, that have to be made by some intelligent creatures in civilization.
This one was taken in 1952 by Adamski, and this is an enormous, approximately over 1 mile long spacecraft. This is a picture that I have on my front page. This is a NASA photo. It shows an enormous large object between our orbiting spacecraft and the lunar surface. There's another one behind it up on top, as you see, and also the shadow that is cast on the left of the ship and behind it, showing you that it's about to go. Here's a construction on the moon that looks extremely artificial. Not only is the crater perfectly cut, but this huge setup on this side, on the left side of it, which is about 30 miles in length.
Everything you're saying runs contrary to what we're told about the moon and about what we found on the moon, which suggests that a huge secret is being kept. Why is that secret being kept?
The moon, from a military engineering point of view, would be a perfect base for us. We could go there, we could set up bases, we could live there for a great length of time, and could watch the Earth and as a superior power from the military point of view, it would be a tremendous advantage for us to keep this as secret as possible.
Another planet. I said, Augie, what you been smoking? He said, well, I want to tell you the story. Do you want to hear it? I said, I'm sorry. Go ahead. He said, I have pictures that I took at this meeting. I said, yes, what makes you think that this fellow's from another planet? Well, when he looks at me, he said, I got the distinct impression that he could see straight through me. I said, my mother does that to me now. He said, shut up and listen. Do you want to? Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. I said, what else? He said, the man has a tremendous IQ. He could speak every known language of all the people who were assembled at that meeting. And at that meeting, there were about 11 or 12 languages, foreign languages represented. And he spoke to them fluently in their own language. I said, what else? He said, the man looked so spacey. I said, what else? He said, the fellow had no fingerprints on either hand. Uh-oh. That I want to see. And then without warning, to my right, here comes a figure of a man toward me with his hand outstretched, whose picture I've been carrying with me for over a year. And with his hand outstretched, he said, hello, Frank. How are you? Augie has said that he had soft skin and that he had no fingerprints. So before I let go of his hand, I took the liberty of examining his fingertips, and they were all bald as a peeled boiled egg. No fingerprints. His skin was soft like a lady's skin, like a baby, but it was a grip of a man. How many of you know what I mean by a man's grip? A strong, good, healthy grip. Do you ever shake hands with someone and you prayed that they would bury that dead fish someplace? Frank, how are you? Oh, I'm fine. I'm fine. And then my questions began. What is your name? My name is Valiant. You have a last name? You said Thor, D-H-O-R. I immediately thought of Buck Rogers' comic strip. And he knew what I was thinking. I got the appearance that he could see straight through me. I said, where are you from? He said, I'm from the planet that your Bible calls the morning and the evening star. I said, you mean Venus? He said, yes, we live on the inside of the planet. When did you arrive? He said, we arrived in the morning of March 16th, 58. And we depart on March 16th, 1960. All right, what have you been doing since you're here? He said, well, I've been having conversations with several members of the Joint Chiefs, as well as with the President, as well as with the Vice President, at that time, Mr. Eisenhower and Mr. Nixon. He said, I gave them, and he stopped for a moment and he paused. And I could see his facial expression change. He said, I offered them ways and means for the people of the United States to enjoy the following. Good health, prosperity, and long life. And he said, you know, I was turned down. The president said he'd have to take it under advisement. He had to consult his counselors. And they came back to me, this man said, Commander Valiant Thor, he said, they told me that if I could give them the material that I was giving them, if I were to freely give it to them, and they were to freely receive it, how to get along without sickness, disease, and even death, he said, you would automatically ruin the economy of the United States. Been to Highbridge, New Jersey. There are people in this particular picture that are from outer space. At the same time, I'll point them out. There's Jill, there's Don, and here's Val. Here they are, Val, Don, and Jill. This is what he looked like when I met him in 1959. Next. This is Don and Jill. This is what they look like then, and this is what they look like today.
Seem to have eyes. I don't know what we might look like a few thousand years of living in zero gravity. We might evolve in a different way. Bone density could change. All kinds of things could happen to us. We don't know. So they may be, I mean, they may be our descendants for all we know.
Spiral going in, starting here. here, but then there's Mrs. Parks there, and this seems to fill in what's missing there. But in ways, it's almost like an artist had worked on it. Now here, this is something that does indicate more intelligent interaction with us. This is what I call copycat circle. Because this circle is copying the other circle that has sort of a monument in it. It's trying to duplicate it. This is the equivalent of the monument, and this is the equivalent of this ring here. See? Almost the same size, but it's like saying, look, Ma, I can do it too. Here is that one that had the quadrants, a circle in the middle, with pretty much a swirl, but then quadrants with the wheat being laid down at right angles to the previous one. That would take an awful lot of work. Now we get to what the subject of this lecture is really about, which is decoding. What do they mean? We don't know exactly yet who did it. We know pretty much who did not. But what are they saying? Well, that's another matter. Now there is a gentleman in London named Charles Dobin. He works as a professor in the London School of Asiatic Studies at the University of London, I think it is. And he decided, in looking at these, that he was going to pick the language called Sumerian, or used by the Sumerians, who were really very ancient Iraqis. And they had a language that we called cuneiform. And there are many versions of cuneiform which got more sophisticated over the years, but the earliest version of it had a lot of circles in it. And that was used around 3100 BC. According to Mr. Dauban, and he interprets this as one of these circles means a well in that form of cuneiform, Sumerian. And according to him, these symbols mean multiply. So his answer is to multiply your wells is the message. I have to question it, though, because he doesn't say anything about this, this, or this. And also I found out by consulting with some other experts on Sumerian, they told me that these symbols also can represent numbers like 36,000 and 3,600 and 10 and 36 and other numbers like that. So it can be questioned as to whether that is really what it's saying. I thought about it and I said to myself, well, one of these days we'll have the answer. It'll just be sooner or later. Next. It's also very symmetrical. And I see a few symbols here which we were in the other one. So it's a bad place to have an encampment, a bad place that if anomalous flying objects are able to go into the water, as Bill Moore talks about, maybe they can go into the land also. Maybe they have a way of penetrating the earth as if it was just like air. But we can't go down there. And maybe when they go into the earth in the area of these crop fields, they create these patterns as they go through. And maybe to keep us off base and confused, they make a different pattern every time. Maybe it's a competition. Spaceship A says, well, I can outdo you. We could be more inexplicable than you are. So they come out and make another pattern.
Okay, we're talking this evening with Tim Beckley, who is the organizer of the National New Age Truth About UFOs Conference, which is just concluding in San Diego, California. Tim, I wonder if you could tell me, how is it that you got into this business in the first place, organizing UFO conferences?
Well, actually, I guess it would date back to my first UFO sighting, which was when I was 10 years old. I was living in New Jersey. And it was a warm summer evening in July or August of the year. And we were sitting out on the front stoop. This was back before, in the days before everybody had air conditioning. So we were just kind of sitting out there, cooling off in the summer breeze. And somebody came running up to the stoop where we were sitting out. I guess my parents were there, maybe a couple of neighbors. And pointed out two objects in the sky. one of which seemed to be directly overhead, and one that was across the street over an abandoned factory building. And these things just rotated up in the sky. One would stay there, and then it would rotate, and then go across, and the other one would come over here. And this went on for about maybe 15 or 20 minutes, and then it just looked like somebody pulled a light switch, and the object went off, and it was gone. And the other one rotated for a while, and finally just lost interest in it and went inside. And the next day, there was a little item in the newspaper to the effect that other people had witnessed this phenomenon, but the authorities were saying that it was nothing more than a weather balloon. And this was not a weather balloon. This wasn't something that was bobbing and weaving in the wind. This was something that seemed to be under intelligent control.
I got it all.
We'll draw it out.
Yeah,
we'll draw it out.